One of the age-old questions in qualitative research is whether data, or the interpretation of those data, are true representations of the phenomenon being observed. Let me see if I can give you a real-life example. Several years ago, I was interviewing a student who was required to take developmental math at a community college. One of my interview protocol questions was, "Tell me about your experiences in math in high school." He described having always been good at math, and that he'd always earned great grades. At one point, he said, "I just think that high school teachers were better at teaching me than these college professors." But here's the deal. I had other data. I had his high school transcript. He'd failed Algebra 2 the first time he took it and earned a D in the second time. Then he failed Geometry twice. If I relied solely upon one form of data, that being the student's description of his experience, I might not have had a true representation of the phenomenon I was observing. Conversely, it appears that seeing his high school transcript is also an incomplete picture. It's missing the story of how this young man remembers his experience. Both of these data are important to understanding the phenomenon being observed. In qual research, we're asking for data that cannot be measured on a scale. When data are measurable, we can get some measurement of their validity. In qual research, however, validity is a tricky concept. Some, like Smith, have asserted that discussions of validity have no place in qualitative research. Johnson argued that validity should be considered and proposed a construct for understanding validity in terms of its descriptive, interpretive, theoretical, internal, and external facets. Guba suggested that there are correlates to the positivist paradigms of inquiry that establish credibility in naturalistic inquiry. Where quantitative methods might look for internal validity, qual methods look for credibility. Where quant methods look for generalizability, qual methods look for transferability. Where quant methods may look for reliability, qual methods search for dependability. And where quant methods focus upon objectivity, qual methods attempt to establish confirmability. In all these concerns, the researcher is attempting to, as Cresswell asserted, demonstrate the accuracy of their findings and convince readers of this accuracy. One thing that frustrates students who are new to naturalistic inquiry is that the lexicon is varied. Should we call this trustworthiness or validity? Is peer debriefing a function of credibility or dependability? Well, welcome to the naturalistic world where nothing is ever neat and tidy. Seriously, some of this may be attributable to the non-positivist universe in which qual methods typically resides, but the semantic features of specific terms are still in a bit of flux. But Guba's four major categories, credibility, transferability, dependability, and confirmability, are the most common ways to understand the means of establishing validity or trustworthiness. So, let's describe some of the means by which these elements can be established. Terrell's outline for validity and qualitative research will serve as the outline for our discussion here, though I will be departing from it just a bit. The biggest portion of the discussion of trustworthiness, or validity, tends to be about credibility. How can we be sure that the researcher's interpretation of the data are credible? Consider the student who told me that he'd always been good at math. If I interpret this statement as evidence of shame, how can I establish that I know what I'm talking about? Researchers will typically establish credibility by using at least a couple of the following rationale. Number one, prolonged engagement. If I sat in the developmental class for a semester and I spent a lot of time with the students in that setting, I might be able to argue that I have credibility based upon that engagement. Some include prolonged engagement with the data as well. Researchers who choose to transcribe their own interviews may have a viable argument of prolonged engagement with the data. In other words, I didn't read the text once and come up with some themes and then claim that I understand developmental math. Instead, I spent hours with the transcripts. The key to understanding prolonged engagement is that I'm making an argument that I have credibility based upon a broad timeline. Number two, persistent observation. This is less about the time of engagement and more about the depth or quantity of observations. Your sample size is a part of this argument, to be sure, but there are other ways to demonstrate this as well. For example, if I ask a student in developmental math about their views on math class the day after getting a good grade on their homework, I may get very different data than if I ask the day after he gets a poor grade. Persistent observation gives me more interactions and a richer understanding of the data because I've accounted for more of the variances. Number 3, triangulation. This is one of the big ones in qual research design. As might be inferred by the term, we often think of this in terms of three sources of data, but it could be established through other means as well: multiple sites, multiple researchers, or multiple forms of data. I often like to recommend that researchers think in terms of primary and secondary data. The primary data will be analyzed, and the secondary forms of data could serve as a means of triangulating the understanding of the primary data. These can even be quantitative forms of data or data from the literature. Number 4, peer debriefers. Have you ever asked a friend to read a text to see if it means what you think it means? That's peer debriefing. Peers may be useful in checking my understanding of the data or the implications of my data in ways that add to my credibility. Number 5, another big one is negative case analysis. Our goal is not to prove a thesis. Our goal in qual research is to get a thick, rich description of a phenomenon, and that is rarely universal or one-sided. Negative case analysis intentionally looks for data that argues against the meaning we've interpreted from the data. This provides color, nuance, and richness to our understanding, but it also contributes to the credibility of the researcher. They didn't just decide to report the data that supports a particular point of view. Number 6, referential adequacy. This approach to credibility is represented in the scholarship less than some of the other methods, but it is very valuable. It involves isolating a portion of the data, let's call that part A, and analyzing the rest of the data, let's call that part B. When we've drawn meaning out of part B, we could then open up part A for the first time to see if those themes are represented in that portion of the data as well. Number 7, another frequently used approach to credibility is member checking. Guba and Lincoln in 1989 asserted that this is the most important form of credibility, as it gives importance to the subject's voice. Member checking is the process of ensuring that I understood my subjects correctly or that I'm accurately interpreting their voices. This can be done while collecting the data, but it can also be done after analysis. If I allowed my subjects to see how I coded their interviews, for example, I might get a deeper insight into how they perceive my interpretation. So these are the 7 that Terrell describes, but there are lots of other approaches to credibility as well. One that I find especially valuable is to keep a reflexive journal to evaluate my own thinking in reference to the phenomenon in an asynchronous way. Another valuable approach is for the researcher to carefully analyze their own lens, particularly in reference to the phenomenon. How does the intersections of my own identity form a lens by which I am interpreting the meaning of the situation? Now, dissertations rarely do all of these methods. A good design will carefully ask which of these are most appropriate to the study. If you have 3 good forms of credibility, that might be sufficient. It's a great idea, however, to describe how you will implement these forms of credibility in your design or analysis. It's not enough to say, I'm going to triangulate. You need to describe how you will triangulate. Transferability is similar to the positivist approach to generalizability. Are your findings and the meanings interpreted from those findings similar to the experiences of others? If I interview Hispanic male students to understand their experiences at a predominantly white institution, I cannot assume that I understand what happens for all or even most students. I may, however, be able to hear elements of meaning that are representative for some students at other predominantly white institutions. Stories and experiences are not generalizable, which is a statistical term, but they may be representative of what some in a population have experienced. The most important means of establishing transferability is to carefully describe the situation being observed. Notice in my example of Hispanic male students at predominantly white institutions, I am articulating a specific setting. That may be different in terms of experience from Hispanic-serving institutions or historically black colleges and universities. The thicker and richer I can describe not just the phenomenon, but the context of the phenomenon, the more I can understand the transferability of the meaning to similar contexts. Shenton suggested that there are 6 questions that can help think through the context. The number of organizations taking part in the study and where they're based. Any restrictions in the type of people who've contributed to the data. The number of participants involved in the fieldwork. The data collection methods that were employed. The number and length of the data collection sessions. And 6, the time period over which the data was collected. Dependability is a criteria of trustworthiness that may be most difficult to pin down in naturalistic inquiry. The idea of dependability is somewhat related to the idea of reliability in quantitative approaches. If someone were to do this research, would they get similar results? Guba and Lincoln claimed that attending to credibility is a primary means of establishing dependability. I think that there is sufficient room to ask whether a qualitative researcher is, by nature, employing their own lens on the data, and we will see things uniquely from other researchers with other lenses. Nonetheless, one might consider, as Shenton suggests, the use of a reflective appraisal of the project, or, as Terrell recommended, an external auditor of the project. Confirmability is the facet of trustworthiness centering upon objectivity of the researcher. Is the researcher a neutral observer? Now, you won't know me long before you realize that I am deeply suspicious of any claims to neutrality amongst naturalistic researchers. Objectivity is impossible, and anyone who claims that they are unbiased should stop doing so. That said, we may be able to demonstrate by what lights we reached our interpretations. When the researcher rehearses the intersections of their identity that craft their lens, then the researcher can engage in the analysis with an awareness that, I am a cisgendered white male first-generation college student with tattoos, and understand the lights by which I interpret the data. Other means of establishing confirmability might be created in an audit trail or even having a confirmability audit. If you're working on a dissertation, your chair or a committee member might be willing to conduct a confirmability audit to ensure that what you're observing is not unique to your own lens. One thing you may have noticed as we've discussed these 4 areas is that they may be overlapping. In fact, they sometimes overlap with entire elements of the project design, like in the case of transferability. Also, you're likely to find that only some, if any, of these facets are described in many qualitative journal articles. As you consider building a qualitative dissertation design, however, you should think about addressing all 4 of these criteria of validity or trustworthiness: credibility, transferability, dependability, and confirmability. Considering each of these elements will ensure that the rigor of your own study and the validity of the meaning you interpret from your data is effectively communicated in ways that your reader can trust.